The last-minute jam was never canceled, and the time slot never changed, even when bands such as Nirvana were booked to play.
Yeah, well, I miss it. I miss it, and I made lifetime friendships from, you know, from the people that I met there. And, you know, the people I never forget. You know, and with this new media, the Facebook social networking thing, you know, getting back in touch with these people, and it's like we haven't missed a day. You know, and that's nice. You know,
there's always going to be an attempt to recreate a moment, a situation, a band, a relationship, a venue. There's always going to be somebody or some gathering of people to try to recreate, you know, something that was great, like the Dobbs situation. And they're never going to recreate it. They're never going to duplicate it. At best, they can hope for, you know, a cyclic change where sometimes you're down, sometimes you're up. There's going to be a point when, you know, there's a new guard of people that create a situation that is going to be the new living room, you know, for a new group of people. And, you know, maybe all of us that were part of, you know, Dobbs back then, you know, maybe we can latch on to some new situation now and then, but, you know, we're still going to just come and go as we get older. We're not going to be totally like, come on, man, we were in that club 5, 6, 7 nights a week.
I mean, you know, nobody can top that run from, I think, 75 to, like, you know, I mean, you know, with a 10-year anniversary thrown in, I mean, I don't think anybody could have topped that run. And I just think it probably ran its lifespan. You know what I mean? I know they did start booking, you know, some of the modern rock stuff and stuff that came along. But, I mean, you know, Dobbs went through a lot of changes from, you know, from the grunge and before that, the kind of REM kind of bands and then our bands. So, I mean, it covered a lot of bases. So, I mean, I just think it kind of ran its course.
You know, there's never going to be another CBGBs. That, you know, had its own history. You know, and Dobbs is as prolific for Philadelphia as CBGBs was for New York. You know, Dobbs never played second fiddle to that situation up there. Dobbs was our CBs in a way. It was our place that put the city on the map musically. So when people do the get-togethers, that's great. I like, you know, whether it's another wake, God forbid, or just somebody's getting married and a bunch of us are like there or something like that, or even just a party or get together or some great band gets together, you know, hey, what if Winkle comes out and says, I'm going to do the Wanderers? You know, everyone's coming out, man. Everyone's going to come out and check that out. So I'm all for somebody trying to recreate that environment, but, you know, it'll be new. It'll be different, which is as it should be.
Dobbs was a regular club, but it was the quintessential rock and roll club, but they also had other musics. But people actually came to listen, you know, unless they were upstairs doing something else. But, you know, you'd look out in the audience and people there standing were riveted on the band on stage. And so you really felt that they were there to hear the music.
Having no family up here, you know, there are people that worked at Dobbs became like family, like Maria and Daoud became like family and stuff, you know. And it was just a good place to go. And I met people who have become lifelong friends. That includes the staff there and musicians.
First, the cover story was George Thurgood. And so JC Dobbs is legendary for me. And it is what South Street is, all the clubs down there. But Dobbs was family.
The dressing room itself would probably be worth thousands of dollars just for all the names that were on the walls there.